Today we're gonna. I'm just gonna touch briefly on one topic, and that's gonna be called baptism in the Holy Spirit. Baptism in the Holy Spirit. If you have your Bible, Book of Acts, chapter 2, and verse 4 says the following. Well, I'll read from verse 1, 2, and 3, but only verse 4 is gonna be on the screen. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. There then appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one set upon each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Somebody say praise the Lord. Baptism in the Holy Spirit. Now there's about 7 baptisms that are recalled in the Bible. The 3 major ones that most of us are going to be aware of or come in contact with. The first one is the baptism of the Holy Spirit into Jesus, which produces salvation. The Bible says that by one Spirit we were baptized into the body of Christ. That means that when you come to the altar for salvation, the Holy Spirit invisibly baptizes you into Jesus. Now, word baptism means to immerse. Word baptism means to dip. It's almost like when you take a cloth and you put it into a dye, and the collar and all of the stuff, you know, gets filled into a dye, and the cloth gets filled with that as well. And that's exactly what happens when you get saved, is the Holy Spirit takes you from being Martinez, Lopez, Savchuk, and the Smith, and He puts you into Christ. That's why when you die, God is going to open the gates of heaven to Christ, and you happen to be in Christ. Somebody say amen. That's why you're not going to hell. Why? Because Christ is not going to hell. You are in Christ. Many people live in their crisis, but we as Christians, we live in Christ. There could be crisis in our finances. There could be crisis in our marriage. There could be crisis in our job. But my life is anchored in Christ Jesus. Somebody say amen. How do I know that? How do I get that? When you get saved, Holy Spirit puts you in Christ. If you watched you heard a story about how Greeks conquered city of Troy, is that they produced this horse and they put soldiers into that horse, and city of Troy didn't welcome the Greeks, but they welcomed the horse. And when they welcomed the horse, they also welcomed anything that was in the horse. See, when you're gonna die, heaven is gonna welcome Jesus. And because you receive Jesus, Holy Spirit baptize you in Jesus. You are in the Trojan horse, and the gates of heaven are gonna open to Jesus, and you are in Christ. Somebody say amen. That's why it's the most important to bring people to church. It's the most important to invite next Wednesday, every service, so that people don't get into religion, into Jesus. The second baptism is the one that we frequently hear in our church and in the Bible. It's the water baptism, baptism in water. Baptism in water is done by a preacher for identification. So the first baptism is done by Holy Spirit into Jesus when we get saved. The second baptism is done by a preacher or a pastor, clergy, priest, into water. And this one is not for salvation. It's for our identification with Jesus Christ. When you get saved, when you follow Jesus, the Bible says that you have to publicly declare of your decision to follow Jesus. Water baptism is a public expression or public declaration of an inward decision. Somebody say amen. So public declaration of inward decision. It's kind of like when you get married, you know, and then you wear a ring. A ring is not marriage, but married people wear it. Now the challenge we have today is we have a lot of people who come from a Catholic background, or those even who didn't attend a Catholic church, but they grew up in a Catholic family. And when they come to church, you know, that is completely wonderful until the idea of baptism appears. And for a lot of people, you know, their family begins to, and we've had cases here where the family turns against them and begins to say that, you know, you're betraying your Catholic faith by getting baptized. But it's good to get baptized as a child. As a Catholic person, those of you who come from a Catholic, you have to understand where child baptism began in Catholic Church. It began when nations started to come into a church, and they started to come from being a pagan and being involved in witchcraft and occult, and the local priest would pray for the family, and he would pray for the children by spraying water on them, not for baptism, but for breaking generational curses that were attached to the family. And with time, that became a ceremony, that became a tradition, where now it's just a routine. It's no longer had anything to do with disconnecting with curses. It's just part of the baptism. But the Bible is our standard. It's good to get sprinkled with water. Not just when you're a baby. Every day it's good to be sprinkled with water. But it's not biblical baptism. Biblical baptism is in the Bible, where Jesus was baptized as an adult. Baptism follows your decision to follow Jesus Christ. And when you're a baby, you didn't make any decision except poop, cry, and sleep. You didn't make a decision to follow Jesus. So that's why when you become an adult, when you know what you're doing, you make a decision to follow Jesus Christ. You have to publicly, like the Lord Jesus Christ, get water baptized to identify yourself with Jesus. When you go into the water, it symbolizes when Jesus died. And when Jesus rose from the dead, it's like you rising back from the water into walking into a new life. Can somebody say amen? Now, I understand some people may say, Vlad, I am not ready. I'm not ready to get water baptized. And I usually ask them the following question. Have you given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? They said, yes, I have, but I'm not ready to get water baptized. And I said, you sound very absurd. It's like a person who got married and says, I'm not ready to wear a wedding ring. I'm like, you should have thought about not being ready to get baptized before you got saved. When you make a decision to follow Jesus, it's kind of like you got married and getting water baptized is publicly declaring of that decision to follow Jesus. And to say that you're not ready to get publicly baptized when you already made a decision to Jesus, that's like a person who, you know, gets married with his wife and says to his wife, I'm not ready to sit close to you in church. Well, you should have done that before we got married. You don't get ready by being holier. That's just an expression. And after that, your life begins to change for the glory of God. Can somebody say amen? The third baptism, which is very powerful. And that's the baptism of Jesus into the Holy Spirit. So the first baptism is the baptism that Holy Spirit, He puts us into Jesus. The second one is when the preacher puts you into water. And by the way, if you are here and you have not been water baptized, but you have given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I will highly encourage and recommend to you. Next Wednesday is the perfect time to get water baptized. And this Friday you can come to the class and learn more about it. We can answer some of the questions and get you prepared. And then next Wednesday you can get water baptized and then continue to grow in the Lord. Somebody say amen. I know some people are getting baptized. How many of you are excited for the baptism next Wednesday? Yes. Some of you, you need to get rebaptized. I didn't hear you. How many of you excited for water baptism next Wednesday? Okay, because I was about to think maybe we need to offer second baptism for people. No, we only offer one. Baptism of Jesus into the Holy Spirit for the manifestation or for ministry, for empowerment, for power. So this is a baptism that Jesus does, where Jesus baptizes you into the Holy Spirit. So the baptism is done by Jesus into the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist declared about Jesus, he actually told first to all of us that Jesus is the baptizer with the Holy Spirit. When people were coming to John to get baptized in water, you know, that was good. But John says, what do you guys see here is great. You know, everybody gets dunked into water for repentance of their sin. But he says, the Messiah, Jesus, is coming. And see, most of us know Jesus for one thing. He will die on the cross. But John didn't say that. John said he's coming. And guess what he's going to do? He said he will baptize people, not into the liquid water, into the liquid fire. He said he will baptize people into fire. And then next day, John said, oh, by the way, he's going to die for your sin. See, for most of us, we only know Jesus as the one who, the Lamb of God, and He is, and without that, we would never be saved. But Jesus, after He died, He ascended into heaven, and one of the jobs that Jesus does today is He intercedes for us, and secondly, He baptizes us into the Holy Spirit. Now, I understand you may say that, you know, why would He do that? This is one of the most amazing things about Jesus. It's not only that He gave His life for us, He gives us the salvation. It's that He gives us the same access He had to the power and the person when He was on this earth, which made Him who He was. See, many people see Jesus on earth as fully God, 100%. But Jesus on earth acted not as God. Otherwise, he couldn't tell us, the works I do, these you'll do and more. You can never be like God and better than God. Jesus on earth lived like a man fully immersed into the Holy Spirit. That's why when he left, he says, I'm not only giving you salvation, I'm giving you the same power, the same person I had connection with from the day I was born to the day I died. And that is one of the greatest gifts Jesus can give you after your salvation. Somebody say, praise the Lord. You know, sometimes you meet people who become very successful and they do certain business or they have certain connections. And they don't share anything with you. They don't give you any connections. They brag about how good they are, how much money they make, what they do, and how successful they are. And when you try to poke around the hole just to sneak in to see what they're doing, maybe it will work for you. They shut you down very quickly and almost like say, that's never ever gonna work for you. Have you ever had that happen to you? Have you ever done that to somebody? You know what Jesus does? Not only he invites, he says, when I go to heaven, he says, every one of you, I'm going to be introduced you to the same power I was receiving every single day when I was on this earth. The power that made me walk on water. The power that made me be born from a virgin. The power that filled me at the River Jordan.